Okay, so let's quickly go through. Yeah, one of the easiest ways, by the way, is that the Asian elephant has a
arched
back, whereas African elephant mastodonta has a saddle. Yeah, sometimes there's a joke that it looks like God has made the African elephant to ride, but we ride the Asian elephant. The ears, somebody said, you're right. Very simply, the ears of the African elephant resemble the shape of the map of Africa, if you know that, and it's much larger, fan shaped. Yeah, ours is a little smaller. Some people tell me that it looks like India. I don't think so, because Kashmir definitely doesn't seem to be part of it. But Africa looks more or less like Africa. More difficult ways to tell them apart, if you look at the tip of the trunk, you'll see that the African elephant has two tips, whereas we have only, our elephant has one finger on the lip. Okay. And the teeth. If you can ask an elephant to open its mouth and feel inside, you'll find that our elephant has ridges which are big and large, and you can feel it. The African elephant is a little more. In fact, the name Loxodonta means lozenge toothed. Yeah, it's like a lozenge with many ridges which you can, which are much more fine. So I'm going to focus this talk largely on the ivory, right? And somebody here correctly said that if you see an elephant in the wild with young ones, then in Asia you will see an elephant without tusks, because our females do not have tusks, right? And some of our males also do not have tusks, by the way. Whereas for African elephants, the females have tusks. Right? So that's the big difference. So 20 years ago, I was also in a metro station, but a Japanese metro station, trying to deal in ivory. I was actually dealing with a very difficult film crew, which was trying to make me recreate what I did the year before, which was, I had gone undercover for 2 years. Now that is 20, it's actually 22 years ago. I can say things. But for many years, nobody knew. But a couple of years, I was undercover in China, Japan, Hong Kong, Singapore, Thailand, trying to track where our ivory went. That's why I'm saying 20 years later, when I'm hearing these stories, it's absolute flashback for me. It's exactly the same sort of thing, a little more sophistication. There was a National Geographic crew which was trying to make me reenact some of this. And I got very, very angry with them one day. And that was in the metro station, because they loved the bullet trains, you know, the Shinkansens of Japan. And this filmmaker was keen that I conduct a deal with the mafia, the Yakuza of Japan. It was very important that it should be the mafia who come there, because they needed to have long mustaches for the film, right? And he wanted me to conduct this with a bullet train in the background, because it made for good film, he said. So the whole world would listen, you know, when we look at a bullet train. How in the, you know, name of God, do you actually conduct an undercover operation in a metro station? So anybody from Lama Metro here, you can try that. I'm not sure. It was a very, very difficult idea. I walked out of the film, but then I was persuaded just to finish it. So I spent two whole sleepless nights in the Japanese underground trying to track this thing, and I actually got him a shot in a bullet train station trying to do an ivory trade with a Japanese market. But it started from southern India, close to where we sit, and Sri Lanka as well, where for about 6 years, I tracked the ivory trade, the poaching, the killings that were happening largely in southern India at that time, and a little bit in Orissa, but really mostly coming out of southern India. And at least a couple of my old colleagues are here, or colleagues of old, they're not really old colleagues, one in the front here, one in the back there, who helped in our travels together. We did the first major seizure. If any of you go and Google Operation Hot Pursuit, I think they still show it once in a while when they run out of other films to show, right, as fillers or whatever. But you'll see the story. But this starts actually in North Karnataka, where we did an operation with a couple of tusks seized in the middle of the forest. It's a whole big story, I will not get into it, but it nearly cost us our lives. But I did manage to get the tusks out for the Karnataka Forest Department with my colleague in arms, Mr. Ashok Kumar. The two of us had started Traffic India together in 1990. And Ashok Kochar, on his way here, tripped and fell in Bangalore and actually broke his leg. So I told him, don't come for the operation, but he insisted. He said, no, I'll come. And he came as a buyer, Lalaji from Dubai. I was a local operator, and we managed to seize those two tusks and then took that trade link all the way into Singapore, from Singapore into Philippines, from Philippines into Japan. That was the film, actually. Utility of ivory. All of you are very quick at telling me the difference between Asian elephant and African elephant. Why are elephants killed? What is ivory used for? Anybody?
For handcuffs?
What? Gauze?
No. The riders,
it's for their personal scenes, the Japs and the Chinese.
Yeah, you obviously know it all, right?
Okay. Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah. 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 So, mostly, yeah, okay, it's ivory artifacts and all was something we used to have a domestic trade in India, but over the years that has gone off. 65% of the world trade is for name seals or hankos, as they call it in Japan, or chop, as they call it in China. Another 10% is for netsuke, these carved objects, which are beads, which are used to hold a Japanese lady's kimono together, you know, the drawstring that closes them together. Now, the Japanese ladies should keep their kimono together. I'm absolutely certain of that. But why they need to use ivory drawstrings to do that, I do not know. Right? And name seals is because the Japanese and the Chinese, their alphabets, their characters, whether they sign or write, it looks the same. There's no way of linking, there's no cursive writing in their script. So how do they sign a check? Yeah? So in the olden days, they used to have wood or buffalo horn, and they used to dip it in ink and carve the name, and I'll show that in the back. And they are called hankos. So as I said, I went undercover into Japan and learned that our ivory, Asian ivory, largely Indian ivory, is called togata in Japanese, and that cost at that time 4 to 5 times as much as African ivory. And even African ivory, they graded into 2 or 3 parts, and I'll show that in a little bit. I never actually put down money and traded in ivory, but I traded in a number of other things as an undercover business to be known as an ivory trader. I kept as close to myself as possible. I'm originally from Kerala, so even in the trade, I was a Malayali trader based in Dubai. It's very believable that Malayalis are the most counterful in the trade possible. So if I pretended to be a Malayali trader, most people believe. I spent months trying to figure out, no science tells the difference between Asian elephant ivory and African elephant ivory, or even between grades of African elephant ivory. So all the same, yeah. But the trader pays many more yen or dollars for different categories, depending on various grades. I'm not going to repeat them. You can look at it, and if any of you want to know further, and if you can find a copy of my old book called Duster, the Surya Asian Elephant, then you'll find some of these grades in it, yeah. But obviously, when you take a set of hankos, they know from where it has come. Is it South Africa? Is it Eastern Africa? Is it Western Africa? Is it India? And they pay different monies. So there must be some difference if they pay different money. It's largely based on capillary action. What this block of ivory can absorb in terms of ink, because it's used as a seal. And some of our things can absorb the ink faster, and therefore Indian ivory and parts of Asian ivory are called blood ivory, because it absorbs the red ink much faster and is much more preferred as a seal. Another important thing all of you should know, every layperson should know, yeah, is what is a Shringa line? Now, Shringa line sounds terribly complicated. And I don't know, you may ask me why should every, you know, layperson know. I'll tell you why. Because as a part-time enforcement officer, at least an honorary wildlife warden of Delhi, I keep getting calls all the time saying, sir, there's ivory being sold here in the shop. Yeah? And you go and you find it's bone, or you find it's plastic, or you find it something else. So it's very important for you to know what ivory is. Yeah? Everybody goes and, you know, our vigilantes nowadays, which is very good. But at least get to know what ivory is. If it is actual ivory, you will find these characteristics marks, which are triangular hatch marks. Okay, and I'll show you some things else which are not ivory also, it'll come to in a minute, which are called Shringa lines. Now, if you can actually photocopy any ivory object on a photocopier, and then when you get a photocopy, just look at the angle, you can even say the difference between mammoth, which is an extinct animal, whose tusks are still in play. You may still find it in Bangalore, yeah, somewhere, and African or Asian ivory. Right. So that's mammoth, angle is less than 90 degrees, and if it's more than 150 degrees, it is living elephants. We do not know the difference between Asian and African, but we know it's a living elephant. Now, if it is bone, it will be straight lines. Very simple thing. You will not see the triangular markings. Alright? Sometimes, because our ivory objects are polished, please look at the unpolished surface. So look at the bottom of a statue or something if you find a bangle, look at the inside of the bangle, right? Which is unpolished, and then look with a magnifying glass, or even just hold it up to light, you will see the triangular markings if it is ivory, or straight markings if it's bone. If it's plastic or something else, just poke a pin into it here. If it's plastic, you'll get the smell of burning plastic. Yeah, just heat a pin and pregnant women. The smell of plastic is absolutely unmistakable, a burning plastic. So you cannot mistake it for anything else. Thereby you can actually go into the real problems and stop getting enforcement officers running after fake problems. So this is a Hanko. This is the name of a person, Sakamoto, actually. And there are grades of this ivory being sold in those days in Japanese. Today the Japanese market has gone down, China has gone up. Markets. So this is not an esoteric art object that two people have. This is a general common supermarket good. Yeah. We have too few elephants to actually support this sort of a trade, and I'll come to that now. And these lovely ivory netsuke pieces, as I said, they're just drawstring beads, but they're carved intricately, and each one costs millions of yen. Yeah, they're called art, netsukes or art objects. And as I said, they will differentiate between, on the left, a African ivory, to the middle, Asian ivory, to the right, a savannah, East African ivory, by various characteristics which science has not proved, but the trade knows, the poacher knows. They're going after various kinds of ivory for various things. I figured out, because I lived in the home of one of the largest traders. In the room I stayed, below my room was a garage. In that garage was 9 tons of ivory. Every day I used to get up and grieve. It was a person. But over the months I kept visiting up and down. The only good thing I can say is that this man, who was then the second largest trader in Japan, has given up trading ivory. I worked on him every morning and breakfast, slowly. Yeah. And eventually, he didn't know at that stage what my identity was, but much later, I did go and visit him and tell him my identity. And he respected that. And we didn't do any enforcement action against him because he was really going out of the trade. And I wanted to encourage at least one major trader to publicly declare that he will not get back into trade. So he didn't. Yeah. But as I said, it's not a handicraft. Don't think that these that the demand that's killing our animals is just for carving few statues sitting in Mysore. No. This is a proper mafia feeding, a proper illegal trade, which is global. I just want to quickly skip that there are heroes in Japan and China also, and that's very important. We very often like to, you know, criticize those Japanese, those Chinese killing our tigers, killing our elephants. It's important that the change comes from within. Just like they keep saying, just like you have Ayurveda, you kill lots of plants. We use animal parts in our medicine system, in our cultural things. It's a very difficult concept to make them understand this is different, because in our minds it's different, but in their minds it's not different. But as the change has to come from within. There are good people who are doing it. But in those days, this is one seizure we did in Jaipur, where the police had actually thought that these are waste products and thrown away all these things called inzais, thinking it's crap, and only seized the ivory paintings which were being made in Udaipur. So they said, thought that was ivory and this was crap. But this was the hankos, which are, it's called inzais, a rough block, and then it goes to Japan and they actually polish it and make it into hankos. So people need to know how to look for it. Ivory trade is a seizure in 2006 that we helped in. A timber truck going into Hong Kong, carrying timber, next. Yeah? Nobody would find there's ivory. Even if you lift it, you would not find that there's ivory. And people, I'm just showing you the difficulties of enforcement. It's not so easy to stop the ivory trade. Next. And you can go through the next few things. We took out all the timber and got this truck x-rayed actually. Next. And then we found there is a secret compartment. There's one compartment that is not being shown, right? So only through an x-ray, only when we have a large enough x-ray to pass a truck through, which we have in Hong Kong, luckily. If this happened in Bangalore, I don't even know if they have an x-ray machine of this size to do that. Next. Yeah. So then we broke open that compartment with the Chinese authorities, like Hong Kong authorities in those days. Next. Yeah. See? So that's what's got out of that truck, which looked like as if it was taking timber. This is going from Hong Kong to mainland China. So what is wrong in ivory being traded and elephants being killed? So you must remember next, that ivory is a finite resource extracted from endangered species, not something that you can just keep producing. The African forest elephant and the Asian elephant have been endangered for a large number of years. By the way, for those of you who don't know, perhaps there are 3 elephant species, not just Asian and African, but the African ones now, the savanna is different from the forest elephant. So there are probably 3 different species of elephants. It's a very funny thing, no? As children, you're always taught there are 2 kinds of elephants. We don't even know, this is the ignorance we live with. We do not even know how many kinds of the largest mammal we have in this world. There are Is it two or is it three? Maybe there's four. There's another one in Borneo, their genetics is separating into separate species now. So every 10, one species, even if there's plenty of them, will affect our species. Although this is a popular way, I've shown these seven arguments. I use this in the United Nations with heads of state and other people who still don't seem to understand. They say, oh, this is trade, it's just, you know, it's ivory, it's benefiting poor people. What's wrong? An elephant dies and you can just use it. Our elephant, the Asian elephant, by the way, there's nothing called an Indian elephant. It's called an Asian elephant. It's found in 13 countries in Asia. It's about 35,000 to 45,000. Although in India it has been stable more or less, in Southeast Asia, there have been declining population and the species is endangered across most of its range. Also, in 1989, when we put it on CITES, there was a famous set of scientists who published a paper, elephants are not beetles. They're not indeed, right? You cannot think they're beetles. They're slow growing, slow breeding, long lived, socially complex, and sexually dimorphic animals. They're very complex animals. They're near persons. I always say that they're more like persons than many of my friends. Right? So if you know, I mean, it's very difficult to know elephants. So as I said, in our elephants, only the males are tusked. Don't go into the details because as I said, I use this at various forums, but just understand that if you just take out the males, obviously you will get a highly skewed population. Totally against what Darwin said, natural selection means the ones, males which have the longest tusks, the most healthiest males will survive. No, here's exactly opposite. The butcher is taking out the healthiest part of the population and leaving the diseased, old, young, and those males which are not that genetically viable back in the population. So you're actually affecting the population. Plus, the whole elephant biology, yeah, makes it extremely unsustainable. It's not like a factory production of ivory. This is the argument that South Africa gives, or Southern Africa gives, Namibia, Botswana, yeah. They're the ones who want to sell their ivory in the global market. And you know, there is no meeting in the world every 10 years or every 2 years where we sit and discuss whether a drug should be made legal or whether a gun should be given to their children. But there is this meeting that happens once in 3 years where all the United Nations, all the countries sit very formally and discuss whether we should reopen trade in rhinos and ivory, right? Or whales. There's another one coming up in Johannesburg, it will be my 28th year if I go there. And it will be the same arguments all over again. This is the argument. That there are too many elephants, elephants need to be killed, it generates revenue, the resources need to be used. We are a poor continent, Africa, so let us use them. Too many elephants is a value judgment. Yeah? In Zimbabwe, there's a 2.6 elephants a square kilometers. Given Zimbabwe's human population, elephants need to be killed. Nagarole is 4 elephants a square kilometer. We call it a national park. So what's the difference? India has a bigger population than Zimbabwe. Yeah, even density is more. So what's the difference? The attitude of the Karnataka as compared to Zimbabwe, right? So people's attitude is critical in determining how many is too many. Elephants need to be culled. Not really required. That's one way of controlling population. But another way, the other ways, the reproductive ways of controlling population. And in fact, you should have habitat ways also. Don't keep making water holes. Tourism. All of you like going and seeing elephants in Kabini and other places. Yeah? Because of tourism, more and more water holes are being done. And that's disastrous. You let nature take its own course. Some elephants will die in drought. That's good. It's natural. Don't keep propping them up and then say, oh, they're entering Mysore. Right? You can't have this and that. Generates revenue. Generate revenue from an elephant, but a living elephant generates so much revenue in tourism. And this resource should be used locally to the poor people who are actually living around the elephant and not actually, you know, sent to China and ivory to make hankos. As I said, my early work shows that there's only 6 or 7 traders which are benefiting from this entire thing. There are 8 people actually in those days. I don't know how many now. 8 people who are controlling the entire ivory trade, global trade. What is the point of making 8 people rich and actually saying that you're solving poverty in Africa? As I said, there are plenty of studies, don't go into what it is, which show that tourism actually gains much more revenue than elephants that are killed. In Japan, the use of hankos was reducing anyway. Japan was an electronic market there. Surely you can get a way of signing with a little electronic pen which does king, 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 king and puts up 2 cartoons when you sign or something, right? But to think that you need to actually go and kill an animal and take its teeth and make it into things is so old-fashioned. It really didn't gel with Japanese youngsters. It's a tradition that has been propped up by the government. Yeah. Slowly, slowly it's worn off. It's actually worn off by itself. And now, as I said, the shift has gone on to China, which is much more dangerous, but as you heard, there's some good news from there. It's an enforcement nightmare for our, you know, chaps who are patrolling our forests or our customs officers or whoever. How do they tell the difference between hard ivory, soft ivory? One is allowed. South African ivory is allowed. Indian ivory is not allowed. When you seize it, how do you know the difference? Eastern, you have to call people like me. How many of us are there who can actually look at it and tell the difference? who are out of the trade. The traders will know it, but they're not going to help you, right? And finally, an ethical reasoning. Next. As I said, elephants are some of the most intelligent creatures in this world.
Yeah.
I don't mean to be partial. I like all animals, actually. I like dragonflies and butterflies and toads. And I've just met a frog researcher. I love frogs. Yeah. It's very important. But and I'm not meaning it flippantly. I really like them. But elephants are special. Right? They are sentient. They're close to us in compassion, grief, joy, the ability to think, memory, so many things. Yeah? And I really don't think we should be killing them and using their teeth in our daily lives. So that's a purely ethical, philosophic point of view as well, even if you can afford it. So I don't want to end pessimistically. Yeah. And Ganesh Chaturthi will come and go and you throw away the murti and you're happy that you've done your bit to Ganesh. But elephants deserve a little bit more than that. You can't just forget it the moment you walk out of this hall. Right? You have to keep a little bit going in your thought process of what you can do. When I give a talk like this in Japan, and I talk as much as I can every year in Japan and China, you have to talk to them. There's no point in talking to you, actually. None of you kill elephants. None of you use elephants. Possibly. Maybe some of you are ivory, you know. In which case, please don't. Today, I don't even say give it up. Just keep it away. Don't throw it if you're... They got old piece of ivory or something, just keep it away. Get it out of the system. Eventually generations will, you know, take it up. Anyway, there was an old man in the audience in the front and he was very emotional. And he came up to me with tears in his eyes and he said, I'm an ivory carver. He said, 70 years I've carved ivory. He said, I never knew you had to kill elephants. He said, I thought all elephants go to one graveyard and die. Yeah. It sounds foolish to us, but that man really believed it. Yeah. So he called me home. Japanese never call you home, even my best friends rarely call me home. Once I almost died of pneumonia in Japan, then my friend took me home. Otherwise, they don't call you home. But this man called me home, I went. Not only did he call me home, not only did he give me breakfast, then he called me to his bedroom. So I said, this is very, very interesting. A man I didn't know. But anyway, they have their puja room. Their puja room is an altar, right? And they worship their ancestors, like we worship our God. And there he had kept, possibly I don't have any this thing, a piece of ivory which had split and there was a bullet in it. And he said, one day when I was working, the ivory split and there was a bullet. He said, then I knew that there was blood on my hands. But I had to feed my family, I knew of no other way of making a living. He said, I took it out of my mind. He said, now I heard your talk, it comes back to me that there is blood on my hands. So he has put those two pieces of ivory next to his ancestors and he was offering it. So instinctively I felt in my pocket, whenever I go outside the country, I carry Ganesha with me. And I gave him a Ganesha, a small Ganesha. And he put that also next to the ivory and he was worshipping it. So the point is next, that you have to talk to them. Now you heard that Obama and Jinping have declared that ivory trade is bad domestically. It's an extremely optimistic thing. I'm an optimist. I'm not a pessimist, other than I've not lasted 30 years in conservation. I finished 30 years this year, right? It's a hell of a long time. You can easily, people ask me, how do you remain an optimist? I say actually Monday, Tuesdays, I'm an optimist. Wednesday, Thursdays, I'm a pessimist. Sunday depends how I get up, which helps a bit. But you have to keep yourself going. So news like this gives you some hope that the world leaders are talking now and making a serious dent. You saw in the Slash's video a famous African elephant. Well, we have our famous Tuskers. Nobody has celebrated them. I wish somebody, maybe Arman Darwin and all can help, put together a book on the individuals. We suddenly think of them as a species. This was Costas Junior. Many of us who studied elephants knows it. Mudumalai, before he was shot and killed for poachers in the late 90s. In those days, you know, finding a tusker with crossed tusks was not as rare. It was rare even then as it is today. When you see tuskers today, the glorious tuskers which the tusks reach your, you know, knees and cross over. So I hope all this that's happening, this global awareness, this political will and what we are doing now will actually stop killing of elephants. But my hope has to be tempered with reality. As I said, they're being killed in Kerala now. Yesterday, one elephant has died in Bandipuri, they tell me. May not be poaching, hopefully it isn't. Anyway, it has died, right? So the killing of elephants or the dying of elephants continues in this country. I've not touched upon conflict about them coming into crops, the land solution, which is another huge thing. But at least in today's day and age, a developing country, or now we are called an emerging economy, right? We are no longer a developing country, an emerging economy. should set the lead and ensure that we stamp out the illegal ivory trade. That's all I have to say. Thank you very much.
We're going to now show you a very short clip. It's called The Last Day. It's really short. I think it's just a couple of minutes. And it shows us very quickly the link between ivory trade and how it either connects or promotes terrorism. I'm not too sure, and I'm really waiting to see the clip. So the panel discussion is around the theme, elephant poaching and ivory trade. Are we in an ivory tower? And we are going to hear from the experts. Panelist number one, Mr. Vivek Menon, no introduction required. Okay, our next panelist, Mr. Sharath Babu, is an environment advisor with the BPMP. He's also a consultant with WWF Traffic and the Honorary Wildlife Board in Bangalore Urban. Mr. Devraj V. Entered the Forest Service in 1997 and obtained training in Gujarat, has worked as an RFO, Range Forest Officer in both Nagarhoveli and Bandipur Tiger Reserve for over 10 years. Mr. Guru Vayarpan has a qualification in MSc Sociology with a background in Geography, is working as a Project Officer and Coordinator for South India of Wildlife Protection Society. Mr. Madhusudanan has spent all his life consumed by the love of nature. And a warm welcome to Dr. Verma. He's the man behind the scenes, not really today, but many, many, all episodes in this series of Friends and Legends. And he's going to be our moderator for the panel discussion. Thank you.
Actually, I was not prepared. I was asked to come. And thank you very much for coming here. And I'll try my best to be a moderator. So I just start with, just want to tell you a few things about Ivory Trade based on my experience. Now, what happens? There are three layers. The elephant gets killed in park forest, then it goes out. It goes into a different stage of transporting ivory and taking it to the buyer, and it's purchased. If you don't stop elephant killed in the forest, then whatever you do, it's very difficult. It's like almost like you spend a lot of your time and energy, lost your needle in the sea. After elephant is killed, try and look for the ivory where it could be achieved. Where is the buyer? It's very difficult. The last part is the buyer. If at all we want to control ivory, the only two ways, to my knowledge, you need to stop killing elephants, and we all decide not to buy it. Not to display ivory. So can we promise ourselves? Now, having said this, I need to make you understand that the middle part, the undercover operation. There are very few experts, and it needs not experience. What I noticed, those days Vivek Menon was there, Sarant was here, and two gentlemen had come from long way. I have never seen a person, any of these people, now currently, or maybe except few. We don't have anyone taking up this operation. Now, this art of undercover operation is dying. If we die, undercover operation will die. So now, if there is a difficulty in stopping ivory poaching, elephant poaching, well, the next level is to stop market. Okay? That needs a lot of work. That is not possible now because the number of people who actually participate in the activity is very, very low. So now, given that, I have a few questions I could ask you to ask, or I could just take it forward. Like, how do we do it? So I just want to make it more informal. I don't want to take it forward in terms of, again, one more technical session. Do you have any specific question to any of these experts? Or can I ask the expert to speak for a few minutes? And I also wanted to export to, we just restrict ourselves to ivory, elephant poaching, trade. And we'll let us not get into the human elephant conflict, habitat fragmentations. They are linked. That's my one suggestion I want to make, because there are a lot of things to learn from ivory trade and elephant poaching, because we have an extremely high quality experienced people are here.
Good evening, everybody. Well, I'm Sharad, and coming to ivory, this is something which is disturbing, because yes, we do find various, right from a security guard till, ex-mayor, leading journalists, this kind of seizure. We've come across various, all kinds of people from all kinds of backgrounds. It's really distressing, shocking. All those facts are there, and we've seen it. Stimulants are there. But sometimes what happens is, especially in places like Kodagu, ancient ivory. People would have born with that. They wouldn't even know, it's something illegal, or it's come to them through generations before 1972, stuff like that. So suddenly, somebody is telling them this, he will get you money, and that enters the trade. So these kind of things, which is suddenly, so you come up, you've been born and raised in that environment, and then you realize there is a value, monetary value attached to that, and then you try to sell it, and then you get caught. It is very distressing. So I think at the end of the thing, I feel education or awareness to people who have these kind of hobbies at home, is very important. Better to be safe than sorry. I think that's something.
Good evening. I'm Devaraj Bhik, faculty of Bhutti Nirmal, and SES in Social Forestry, Bhutti Region. I have written Bandipo and I wrote it for almost 10 years. Actually, I'm having a very good news to tell. I'm a bureaucrat, that's why I'm having a bit of paper. So this is, actually, we were talking about the recent poachings in Kerala. Actually, up till now, the investigation is almost complete. They have arrested, the Kerala Forest Department, they have arrested almost 40 poachers. I mean, we put in middlemen everything, 40% they have arrested. And they have recovered, actually, the estimation is about more than 30 elephants have been killed. Up till now, up till now, I think almost investigation is over. At least 15 carcasses have been recovered. Especially this is the mid part of Kerala. Iruki, Perambukuram. Actually, two divisions, Maliyapattu and Valakkal. These are the major regions where the poaching has been occurred. 15 carcasses have been recovered. 40 members have been arrested. 80 kg ivory has seized. And 12 guns have been seized. And 3 vehicles have been taken to the past parliament district. And the Kerala government has transferred this case to CBI. And actually, they have transferred the case to CBI. CBI has to accept it to know the procedure. It is on the way. So this is the present situation over there. And as we talked, actually, now you know also we have got wildlife areas and territorial areas. As you rightly pointed out, the elephant does not know the reason, difference between the territorial areas or any further any animal. So these poachings, if you look at the recent killings at Malayamadeshwari Hills also, recently on September 15th, right, two elephants have been poached. Actually, those two poachings have been occurred in the territorial division only. Actually, there are a lot of reasons we will discuss it later on. Behind this. So actually the investigation is going on. So this is the present situation. Actually, from my government side, I am saying that we are in the right step. So we are in the right step. We are going to nab these things. We are nab the poachers. Actually, you know national parks and sanctuaries, and now the tiger reserves, critical tiger reserves are coming. Definitely elephants and tiger territories will be overlapped. Actually, in 24, both elephant and tiger coexist together. Actually, wildlife divisions are managed by a separate listings. Actually, if you in a forest department, you have to enforce certain laws. Actually, if you go for a tree cutting, for example, if you want to take permission for a tree cutting, you have to approach the territorial division. It is linked with the people. It is more of a actually people's oriented. While it is exclusively for the protection of the wildlife. If you take, for example, when we go to Nagaland, and recently we have made this Kaveri wildlife. Earlier it was part of the Malay Mandushara division, that is Kollegala division. Yeah. Kollegala division, as well as some part of us in Kanakpura, in the Ramnagar division also. So for administrative purpose, we bifurcated to wildlife these things. Wildlife, there will be intensive perambulation. Actually, we will have more anti-poaching camps scattered everywhere at important places. We will have separate funds from various central government agencies, maybe from Project Tiger, Project Elephant, like that. So management will be easier and more human resources will be there in the wildlife areas. Whereas the RFO or any officer associated with the territorial division, he has to deal with the other aspects also. So in this one, any problems with the outside, he has to interact with the people, he has to interact with the politicians, MLS, everything. So there comes the picture. Actually, in the wildlife areas, there will be almost no disturbance from the politicians, thanks to them. Actually, in my career, I haven't hardly faced any political hurdle in my life.
Good evening, my friends. Anyway, this is good gathering. Then we were talking on the way. These talks need to be talked on the borders of forest. Because people who are engaged in elephant poaching, generally they wish for money, but actually they are not getting the actual money what they expect. Still they are having some expectation that they will get some lakhs and lakhs of rupees to settle their marriage of their daughter also. So for that they are doing. If you get into their house, the poachers, It will be a small hut, maybe some ruined things wherever we can see. Whatever we are seeing, that will be very pathetic condition. So we cannot expect that these people, how they are doing this much, these crimes. So some social issues there on behalf of that. So we are dealing with these people, and we are having some connection with these poachers or former poachers, though they have been to protect us. And many people are supporting the forest department as well as some information will be passed to us. So we will be supporting the forest or the other enforcement agencies like police department or customs people. So through that way, to reduce the poaching rate, some kind of little bit of activities I am involved. Personally working with the Wildlife Protection Society of India, led by Belinda Reid. I am proud to be working with her. And actually it is undercover operation, so popular programs are not there generally. So I am very much proud of that. And the second part is, we are trying to take back the poachers into the protectors. That's the main focus that I work. That's the thing we will discuss. Then the last incident that you have told the Karnataka officer, in that the main trader involved in that poaching case. By Ganesha's grace also. Today is Ganesh Mahotsav happening, you know, in Karnataka. I have a part of that in the afternoon. Shreya Goyal was singing. So somehow some connection is there. Some information could pass to the forest department, and from that the 14 traders could have arrested. Actually those people have been connection for the past 12-13 years. Still they are continuing the trade. That issues there. So we have to, all of us has to work together to cut it there.
Little embarrassing for me to sit with so experienced person. Especially when Rama sir had called me and asked me to come, I was saying you're talking to the wrong person. So, but now I understand the reason, because basically by qualification I'm a management student, and I was born and brought up in Greece, and I moved to Greece, and then the love for nature took over, and now I do conservation, and I've been a conservationist for the last 8 years. I've done a lot of anti-poaching operations and all. And in fact, like Vikman sir was saying, he's a Malayali buyer. I am Malayali by birth, and now I continue the trade. I am a Malayali buyer. In fact, previously in 2012, I think, we recovered a leopard skin. And Mr. Jones was the person who, in fact, on telephonic conversation got me through all that. So I think, anti-poaching operation, not like at field level, but at least at city level, at consumer level, I think youngsters play a major role. And the thing is that we are able to understand and appreciate a lot of things, not just nature, but even, we are able to look at the ways the trading happens, and it's better, it's easier for us to actually curtail poaching, because we have access to a lot of things. We have access to hotels, we have access to a lot of people who sell these drugs. Especially as a tourist in a place like Godalur, where I am born and brought up, you have these offerings from the local, the kitchen person, maybe the guide there asking you, would you want to join me for an illegal, like a trek or something. I'm sure everybody loves trekking. But we should look at it from an elephant's point of view, other animals' point of view. And a lot of these trades, especially if you ask Mr. Sharad, he'll be able to tell you how the trading happens. He's from the hotel, he's recovered a lot of things from the resorts and like that. So I think our consumer side, we should be able to do a better job. Thank you for being here.
So now I have one observation, which is what Mr. Goyal, maybe Yavraj could answer. Some time ago, one poacher was given a job. He stopped his own poaching activity, and he was given a job as a forest watcher. Later we found he was not given salary for 6 or 8 months because there was no fund. So my question to the officer was, now you've invited a poacher, just go and work for him. As you don't give a salary, is he not going to tell poachers where the elephants are? So do you have any comments for it?
So our informants,
I will not say watchers. Because what we actually we employ with the not the elephant poachers, actually some small timber smugglers, actually small things. Actually, we used to appoint them. Them as this, our railway level. Definitely, will not take this applying elephant itself poacher. Usually, we take them as informants. In most of the cases, we have tracked. Actually, I have done a few cases which cover also. Actually, we have made undercover operations during the 2002-03. Actually, after those undercover operations, the series of, I mean, the understanding between the Kerala Forest and Tamil Nadu Forest Department, we were able to stop the poaching, elephant poaching, tiger poaching in Bandipur and Nagarode, that Udumalai, Vainat, etc. So, since 2007, no poaching has been occurred in this area. So, as far as funding is concerned, actually it's very difficult to say because it's the flow of money. But good thing is that now in both Nagarode and Bandipur we have over funds. That whatever money comes from the tourism will be deposited there only. Now there is no depth of funds for paying salaries and vehicles, vehicle movements, everything. Actually, we are comfortable right now. I don't think there is any depth of money for paying salaries.
My point was that this is the ideal place for NGOs to pay. The soft hands. Government has its restrictions. Sometimes officers change, sometimes regimes change, funds go. But if you are trying to play with human beings' lives, you know, and poachers' lives, as we said, they're not people who are, like I showed in Japan, you know, just playing large roles and stuff. If you're trying to rehabilitate them, it's a very good time for wildlife NGOs, social sector NGOs to step in and play the soft hand with the government. So when there are such issues, they can, you know, tide over. Human transition takes time. It takes sometimes several generations, but at least one lifetime. So we need that continuation of the social impact. People like Vera Pinnar can play a key role in that.
See, what my argument is that we need to have consistency in what we do. Consistency should terms of the money what is allowed to the department. Like it's not just wildlife protected areas. We have a territorial business. Also, equally, both should be equipped very well. So if they are not equipped very well, then you protect the particular area and your territorial divisions are not equipped well. Because I know many cases, I'm not blaming the department, but you need to seriously argue about it. There's a lack of manpower in most of the cases. And many people don't like to stay in the remote areas. So when people live in happily in cities with all this comfort, why should I live in a remote area, live in anti-poaching camps? So these are the things which we need to discuss, understand. And when we have a discussion and answer, this is a scope for us to go forward. So not just blame anyone, primarily, these are the loopholes. Like if you don't fix these loopholes, then you are fixed. And we have another interesting officer is from Northeast India, Mr. Officer. So he could also share a few minutes of his experience and we'll move on to the question and answer.
Hello, good evening. I am Dr. Guptaju, operation. I served in Arunachal Pradesh for 35 years and 17 years in Namdofa Tiger Reserve. So my experience with elephant and elephant ivory is very less because in Northeast India the most of the elephant they don't have tusks, particularly in eastern side, adjoining part of. So my experience with the tiger, and I can tell the most of the poaching done in Northeast for tiger, not for tusks, for meat only.
Meat?
Yeah, for meat. Most of the time. Because in 2012, I found one carcass. The entire meat was taken away. And that was a makna. I mean, the male elephant without any tusks.
Sir, my question is, what is the profile of the poacher? Is it a standalone poacher in the sense you have guys who are exclusive elephant poachers or poachers, you know, who deal into many poaching activities simultaneously? So, what is the type of profile these guys have?
It's an interesting question which we usually come across, and I know why this question came up in my mind, but yes, it's very important because
Yes, there are people who have been doing this, and suddenly we once in a while get some surprises, because one of the recent seizures, it was just a 19-year-old boy, you know, and that was his first time, and one day two elephants were shot 1 year ago, and surprisingly the department had recorded it as lightning struck elephants. So that situation, yes, we come across these kind of surprises. So it's very difficult to say, okay, this tribe or this caste or this region, like earlier, there is, once you've done it, you've gotten over that, you know, fear, okay, you know how to handle an elephant, you know how to shoot. But now you, it's really surprising that youngsters come up, very, very teenage boys, you know, doing this and admitting that, yes, I've done it. After he has two elephants to his credit already, of course, he's now behind bars. I think I'm answering your question.
Well, my question was, like, say, suppose, is it a standalone elephant poacher or somebody does
this? Let me take a question. Actually, there are people who specialize in certain animals, and even a tiger, a leopard, the fur trade follows a certain route. So there are two things. One is whether a person has the equipment and the knowledge to do that kind of killing. Elephant killing requires a certain kind of equipment. You can't just fire with your .22 and kill an elephant. Right? And knowledge and the wisdom passed on as to where to shoot and how to kill. But it's also the trade routes. You know? Depending on the buyers and middlemen, there will be certain pockets of people who are specializing in it. The rhino horn trade, for example, never mixes with any other trade. Seems to be completely distinct. But there are, as you said, there are crossovers. Pangolin, I don't know how many of you know what a pangolin is.
Yeah.
It's being traded now in vast quantities. Tons are going out of it.
Even in Bangalore, we have a pangolin.
Now, the first few indications we have is that, a very primary indication, that trade route seems to follow the tiger leopard trade. You know, there seem to be buyers who are doing both, and or who are doing tigers and who are not getting tigers and doing pangolins. Yeah. Elephant always used to be slightly distinct in the past, but as you said, maybe there are new people who are coming into the game.
Elephant poachers have a distinctive mindset. So, an elephant poacher, he seems to be doing the same, not like other poachers. So, other poachers may have for flesh or for some other purpose, but elephant poachers, once they do it for a thrill. Just like they start with entertainment, because it is a very thrilling experience for them. They shoot, they have revealed something with us. That they shoot within a distance of 20 feet also. So elephant will come and kneel before them, and at that time they will shoot in the right place. So the blood oozing out, the coming out from that elephant head, they will be very much thrilled out of it. So for that they are doing. That's what one person revealed. So they will do keep on doing that. So not for making money or like that.
Especially the profile, I'd like to add that in an elephant poaching, there is no one person that's going. We have about 6-7 people, at least 3 of them carrying rations for them. So that's a different profile. The Vadigatti, that's the guide, that's the key person. He knows the areas. For example, in our area, there are a couple of people from Wayanad who walk all the way to Sathyamangalam Tiger Reserve. That initially they were doing it only for Sangalore. So now the profile of the guide is totally different. He's a guide, there's one person that Surinder Verma sir and me and myself, we have interviewed. One Vella Abubakar. So he's actually, he's been in the scenario for in the poaching business for at least 20, more than 20 years. And in this 20 years, he's never shot any elephant at all. So in the sense that that's a different profile, he knows the area and he goes along with it. And the person with the gun, he and the marksman is a totally different person. He comes with the weapon, or maybe he borrows a weapon from a known source, and he comes and he knows exactly to shoot an elephant. He can't shoot an elephant at any point. There are special points, I think Surinder Verma sir will be able to tell you. So there are special points, and that profile, those kind of people have the links to do the trade.
Hello, I'm Jayesh Thakkar. So my question is, how good or bad is the connection rate of elephant poachers in India and the agri traders? Do they end up behind bars or do they get away using loopholes in the judicial system?
In general, for forest offence cases, convictions is very, very low. Let me accept that very straight. So actually, we have charge sheeted few elephant poachers in 2006 or 7, still price is going down.
is it because of lack of evidence or lack of follow-up with department? No, actually the system is like that. I would like to answer, and this is very important what the statement is said. I mean, that is the truth. There are many people within the system who are really unaware of, you know, for example, matching which animal product with which schedule. As basic as that, you know, it's really difficult, but yes, conviction is something which, you know, we need to aim at, and since there are many players in it, you know, sometimes police, sometimes forest, and other agencies, it's a very, you know, haphazard thing, but convictions have been not that forthcoming. At the end of the day, it's basically because of awareness at the ABP level, you know, assistant public prosecutor, it involves even the judiciary also. And most of the time, you know, vehicles are released the same day, which is really, one seizure is a lot of effort going in and seizing. And again, it all boils down to awareness. So I don't think it's very encouraging when you look at statistics on conviction and, you know, successful in that.
Very quickly, very low. The Forest Department needs a legal set. Each of these things. It's not just awareness, it's skill, it's professional skill in drafting the case, in drafting the claim to ensure that conviction happens. Then the prosecutor is not concerned, even the basic drafting is wrong in most cases. It is becoming better. That's the good part. I mean, seeing over 25 years, it was very bad. But now there are convictions, so don't lose heart, but we need to make it much better.
I just had a few points on this. There are two factors. One is very difficult to locate the death or elements. After finding it, you just identify when it was killed, who was poached, who was poached. By the time you reach that person, the things would have completely, the person would have escaped. Then, and if you go to individual cases, poaching may come from Kerala to Karnataka, and then when you see the marriage, it will be written in Karnataka. So that all detail of Malayali is in Kannada. Now, how do you have a common language there? Like when you just, when we did our study and compare all the data, and we just see, saw the consistency. Sorry, somebody is not translating this document. Somebody is not taking it forward. They lie in the department. So these are the problems. This part of awareness, there are many factors. You can do a fantastic 10,000 PhD thesis on
that. Good thing is that actually recently there were a few convictions. We have translated in 2007. There was a small conviction in Gundlupet airport recently, and even in Ramnagar also. There was one conviction in a small wide FPS also. Actually, especially the judges, the new judges who are coming, so they are interested. And they are forcing us to charge it and forcing the police department to do better, and they are waiting also. So thanks to judiciary also. Now the things are, as Vivek sir has told,
if legal punishment is not a deterrence, then what would discourage poachers from getting into this? I mean, if they know that they can get away with that, so how do you prevent them from, I mean, what's the cost of getting off?
Legal deterrence is the answer in here. Richard Dickey in
Kenya tried shoot a child. That's not the answer in India. With our sort of population, with the amount of people living in the park, who are living off the park, you have to ensure that people who break the law get punished according to the law. There is no shortcut. No, why would you want a shortcut? We have to tighten the cases and ensure that there is punishment.
Hello, I'm Idris Khan. More than anything, it's government who has to take the serious initiative to do all these things. Unless there is no government support, nothing can be done. And whoever it is at the helm of the affairs, they should have the concern for the environment, elephant, tiger, whatever it is. That is the biggest problem we are facing today, whether it is in the central government or in the state government, whether it is the forest minister, whether it is the chief minister. And you have made such a valuable points and given so much of wonderful information about all these things. This has to be surely shared to the government, state government. Unless and until you don't share this with the state government, who are the people who are at the helm of affairs, and convince them, these things will be very difficult to implement in future, you know.
What about the tusks that are seen, which are being hoarded by the state governments? Like Kerala government has 7,000 kilos of tusks, which they still have. I mean, what are they going to do with it?
We have made some test, huge number of tusks staying in our custody, in Sriganda Kotis, Sriganda Kotis, everywhere. They are in self custody. They will never, I'm sure that they will never come back into the
state.
Actually, it is there. The proposal is there. The proposal is there. It is on. It has to be approved by the government. Proposal is on. And actually, even the military has asked for some tests also. That is not.
By the authority, who are these authorities?
I would like to add to that. See, as of now, I am speaking about Karnataka, you know, the situation has become such that we have exhausted all our, we will find only individual tasks in the, you know, in the stockyard. Everything has been taken over by defense officers from all over India. You will find it in their offices. I mean, that has been legally, you know, decision has been taken by the Chief Value Warden, and that's how since 2011, it's a big demand, you know, for the defense officers to have two tusks at the back when they are sitting. So that is what is
happening. Okay, I quickly say that's a very valid question who asked, right? Any treasury is a soft target. It's much easier to rob a treasury than go into a forest and kill an elephant. So purely in an enforcement sense, it should not be kept. And in many countries, we have encouraged burnings and destruction of stock. Right? In India, ivory is social cultural attachment is there. There may be people in the political milieu who believe it should not be burned. And it's part of our culture. That's your answer. So the chief ministers, others should empower the chief file warden to take that decision. In most states, these files have been going on for the last 10, 15 years, so they should be burned. But eventually, they don't go up to the top and get that sign so that it is burned. And this whole system of army chaps putting it in the back of their tusks, I think should be completely banned and taken away. Anybody in the army here? Yeah. I mean, no. And I'm only asking in the sense people should assist in moving the army culture from within, just like a normal Japanese. I mean, within their own culture, they don't want to sit with two, you know, dead tusks on either side of their head. It should come from the army itself.
Those animals and those messes, you know, have
yeah. All.
Sir, what happens following an elephant's death in the forest, in the wild? Is there a protocol by the central government or the state government as to how an elephant death has to be accounted for and statistics maintained with the department?
Yeah, there are protocols and guidelines issued by the project elephant in the center. And then the state has rules which have to implement. So different states have different rules under the state administration, but following broad guidelines from the project elephant.
I have a question with regard to the health of the length of the tusk. You said the tusk, the biggest tuskers get shot down first and the population gets killed. I just want to know, is there a scientific connection between the length of the tusk and the health of the animal? And does it mean a healthy animal and a better gene because he has longer tusk?
Yes, you can read a paper by Sukumar and Milind Bhakti, which talks about the larger the tusk, the lower the parasite load. Not that the tusk is actually causing less parasites, but it looks like it indicates a healthy animal. There's also some science which shows that female elephants are preferring to mate with elephants with longer tusks. So there are some science. Of course, like everything else in science, there are counter science also which shows that it's not purely conclusive, but there is some science in it.
Sir, how many poachers have been rehabilitated
right now?
Any idea, any number which you have?
Poachers, in the sense, not exclusively, and the young coaches, but very good initiative started in Pedia, even in Bayana. Outside forest department, it is happening. Rehabilitation in the sense, actually, somebody asked about how, what's the conversion rate? Somebody asked about conversion rate of below 5% is the conversion rate to the data. So, rest of the things are being tried out generally. That happens only because the government leader or the magistrate, they doesn't know the actual importance of the elephant or the existence of elephant dog. That's the main reason. And our system, the procedural errors are being highlighted and at least they are being That's the main reason. And regarding this rehabilitation, the poachers who are living outside forest, they are being sensitized. And once in a particular moment, when he realizes that he is doing a big crime, in that very moment he transfers. Then no rehabilitation is required actually, but somehow something will come to him. And to my knowledge, 3-4 persons rehabilitated, to my knowledge. Not officially, unofficially.
Yeah, regarding rehabilitation, the biggest poaching gang in Tamil Nadu is a gang in Kambam Valley. So that's where the Periyar Tiger Reserve comes. And in early, in late 90s, there was a program from Periyar Tiger Reserve saying that you hand over your weapons and be part of the conservation process. And that group is called as Bidumi Group, and they operate out of Gudu. There are the main in the Kambam Valley. There are two villages that have the maximum poachers. One is the Gudulur Valley, that's the Madurai district Gudulur, and not from where I come from. And another one is Varsanadi in the same Kambam Valley. So these people have been encouraged to join Periyar Tiger Reserve as naturalists. And now they work around, they work in Periyar Tiger Reserve. They take tourists for rides on rafting. If you've seen that placement, these are the people who've been over the exposure. And other than that, just the thing is that we know that about Veerappan saying is that Veerappan has been ranging in about 50,000 square kilometers, but it's understood that he's not been ranging the entire 50,000 square kilometers. He's been to point locations. So these ex-poachers who want to be rehabilitated, they help the forest department in identifying these point locations. So if you monitor these point locations, say for example water bodies, maybe a good rock where the elephants can't attack or a tiger can't jump on, so these are the point locations that these people are able to identify. In fact, camping fire and all that. So these people come into the forest department to help in these. That's how they use in Tamil Nadu especially. Okay, thank you.
Actually, the mindset of the people need to be changed by the very good relation with the forest officers and the villagers. That initiative taken in Periyar, that's of Madhu and myself and James Akrayas, we work there only, Periyar only. So on other side of Kerala, a big group have changed their mindset, in Kerala side also. So the approach of the officers towards the culprits, that is the main thing. That has not become success in any other states or any other parts. Only because that listening with the department people and the people have not really happened. By pouring more money into rehabilitate the people will not be a success. The people, the man has every chance to do the same crime. So the relation with the good officers, I know, and actually James Sakharia is not ready to talk with, but I will tell, only because of his relation with the local people and with the former poachers, they have very good relation, and at any point of time the culprit can talk with the officer, even at night also. If there is a good support from the officer, the man will not do the crime. So that will lead to the result. I appreciate James Akrayas. Please give him a clap.
I just to add few points here. It's the consistency in which you continue that is what matters. You start something rehabilitating and just take this person through his life, not for a short period, because their demands are very, very high. My suggestion would be just independently local NGOs come forward, identify such a people, and they come forward to take over and consistently provide support to everyone. Because like their demands are very, very continuous, you need to be there all the time to provide support.
My name is Nishan, by name.
My father is
Steve, sir. When we sometimes go near to the elephant, they attack. Any points to save ourselves by not harming them?
Little underperfect answer, but I'm saying is that I'm just, because the rest is all science, I'm just like you. We both don't have any background in science. If you approach any animal, it's going to charge. any animal. So it's if you approach, it's like threatening them. So you see an elephant, you want to enjoy it, move little away from the elephant and stay at a safe place and watch, then the elephant doesn't charge and you don't have to save yourself.
I'll give you another example. Actually, they don't have sense. They cannot talk like us, but they really know what we think. So if you are in the mode of loving the elephant, it will not attack. That damn sure, that I will promise you, it will not attack.
So recently, one VC from who had come to our office to check her death recently happened when lady was killed. And he was very worried why this death happened. One elephant killed her, just a particular lady. The story was simple. She was chased and she went back to take the bucket what she left. And the elephant was dead, killed. Now this is an issue, has become a very serious issue in Kuk. And the DC was asking us, look, there are many forest officers live there. There are many tribal live there. Many researchers go there. Nobody get killed. Am I right? But why specifically this particular people? To my knowledge, elephants do not specifically kill anyone. So we are all sitting and speaking to you. We have seen elephants many times. So elephant is not a dangerous animal because they have to eat, say, about 18 hours per day. You should not be disturbing. Just if I come and stare at you continuously, what do you do?
At the end of the day, everything falls into numbers. Do we have exact numbers of elephants, that is male, female, in some budget, in cop, needed to have better protection measures or better management? Say, you can have better protection here, get the density is more or where they are more vulnerable.
Well, we have more precise number of elephants across India than many other animals. You can never get exact numbers of elephants.
But elephants have varied between 25,000 to 30,000 elephants. Across India for the last 15 or 20 years, there has been 1,000 here, 1,000 there. It's actually been quite stable. But interesting that you say that you also want to know males, females, and very important to know the demography. And people normally look at only the total number and happy. You know, 1,400 and so many tigers. But how many young ones, how many females? This southern India, we seem to have a good grasp. But northeast India, we have very poor knowledge of our demography. We have numbers. If you ask the government, there are numbers for all states. But I would say southern India, northeast India, we still need much more. But Rajaji got it, the northern population, Orissa and South India, we have far better understanding of the market.
See, now just look at the number. We have 100 elephants in Australia. We just look at the classification, 39% of the adult female, 4% of the male, and some percentage. Now, we need to consider what is the breeding inclusion. So our study clearly indicates that only 14% of the individuals will contribute in breeding. So if you have 100 elephants, not all the 100 elephants are going to be. Now within that 14%, if you know all the males.
I think this, I'm sorry to go off at a tangent, it's a little controversial because we are talking of poaching. But since so many of you are from Kerala, I'd like to say that the captive elephants in Kerala, the ones that are dying, you know, with overwork, torture, whatever you call it. What happens to those tusks? Who's keeping track? And does it go into the market? And why is the department so sort of hesitant to do anything about the tusks of these animals?
I have no number set up. People may think like that. Actually, elephants come under Wildlife Protection Act, no? So that's wild animal. That's a government property. That's the ownership is in the forest department. But sometimes this is being kept with the owners, the temporary owners, no? So some adjustments will, so maybe for a period they will be keeping. But there is no proper records for the number of elephants in Kerala. There are so many elephants transited from other states which is being used in Kerala that is not in record. That is not well. Now the government has ordered for taking the microchips to all the elephants. So actually in my native land, I am from Palakkad. I am also from Kerala only, but Tamil. Okay. In my native place, one elephant came for a temple procession. And when I checked, they were not able to, they were not at all ready to give the records and all. Actually, it was suffering from some stomach issues and all. So when I checked with the website, it is already dead. That the same elephant is there in my native place. The very next day, they have transferred to their own place. So likewise, the actual record is not the original things. The government has to take more attention on it. Kerala state government has taken a first step on that for microchipping all the elephants in Kerala.
Yeah, I think that's part of what she's saying also, and the checking has been there, but very lax. So there is definitely chance of that leaking into the trade, which is what is being tightened up even now. This recent ivory case has also woken up the department on the problems of this ivory moving into the illegal illicit market. Captive elephants in Kerala is a national shame. Even Malaysia, I have no hesitation in saying they are very poorly treated. They are treated as holy cows or holy elephants, and therefore talking about them is not accepted. Yeah, but we treat them very poorly. The ivory is an issue. We do not know how many there are. They are still being caught in the northeast and brought. Still, some illegalities happening in Sokot and Bihar where they are sold. So all this is there. It's not unknown, but anything associated with religion in this country has got its own peculiar complexes. That's all I can say. Yeah, otherwise, if you read Gaja, which is a policy document which is being brought out by MOEF 2 years ago, I remember that committee, very clear on what to do with captive elephants there with IVA. But we need to follow.
There was an incident in Coimbatore in 2014 where we seized the tusks. I think we had about 6 tusks and small pieces which he was referring to. Those small pieces were again made into carvings, elephants, nothing like that. Whatever, the person, the gentleman who was arrested was having captive elephants and they have passed away. So it was more of emotional, it was behind his bed actually. But he was involved in a trade of another tusk. What happened was all the tusks, whether it was captive or, if it's legal, that's a different thing. You're there with contraband, it has to be seized. And the entire products were seized from this house.
I cannot answer from Kerala, but I can talk to you about Bihar. What happens that certain inch of tusk is cut every year, and this money is used to give a salary for the mouth. He gets about 10,000 rupees per year. Okay? That is the money they make every year from cutting tusks. Okay? Where they sell it, whom they sell it, and where it is marketed. Don't ask me, maybe we should ask them.
How do you put poaching activity during and after the elephants type?
Okay, so the question was something to do with the problems with policing and undercover work and say CITES. So the CITES has been around for a while and we see that there are issues with people not being aware of what has to be done when wildlife products are being created. Is that some way of fixing the problem? CITES is an unmentioned, it's there, it's written in stone to an extent. But we don't see much happening. Is it something to do with unwillingness to move things and get things done, or are we focusing too much on, say, drug trafficking or gold trafficking or something else? Is that something that we could address? There are two questions actually. Veerappan is just another poacher with big mustache. So, any organized gang, once broken, there will be a few years of relief. That's exactly what happened in the post war. And what I showed you was that certain, ivory poachers, traders, women have regrouped after 20 years and are continuing. And if you don't enforce now, then another miracle will come. Not because they're afraid, because something happened, but not the other one. Europeans are created by society. It's not an extraordinary human being. Taking advantage of a particular situation, a person will come up. So there was a little lull in answer to your question, but it's come up again.
20 years, you said it's the same.
Yeah, I'm a little unsure what you're talking about, the global reaction to CITES. CITES is one of the most effective UN conventions. Most other UN conventions have been through are even less effective. 90 days after CITES takes a decision, trade changes. Yeah, so it is effective. I don't think it's not effective. The problem is CITES regulates only international trade.
it does not regulate domestic trade in China or inside US or what, right? It also only regulates trade which actually goes with the permit. CITES is not an enforcement agency. CITES is telling you what you can trade or what you can't trade. If you smuggle, it's not CITES' responsibility, Interpol's responsibility or responsibility of various World Customs Organization or others to stop it. They're not an enforcement agency. They can prescribe policy. Right? It's an international treaty of policy. That's the answer. People suddenly think CITES should solve the mess it won't. It's officers like him on the ground and then the customs officers at the border will actually have them. There are 10 people sitting in one office in Switzerland. Can they actually stop crime? They can't.
During Lehman's time, even forest officers don't go for inside forest.
Because for the last 8 years,
for the last 2-3 years, so many elephants killed in Satyajit News now. So many elephants. As Lehman is not there, anybody can go into the forest. So they do not
bear
the forest offices.
Well, I consider, you know, creating awareness the best way to stop poaching. But what is the medium in which you go into? Because I assume the poachers are basically people in and around these forest areas. And what is the medium that I think people use to you know, stop them from doing this? What is the awareness meeting that is?
I just add a word to this, what people do have understood. Actually, now if you look at from the viewpoint of Karnataka only, actually our major threat is around the Kaveri Basin, right? Especially the bordering area between Tamil Nadu and Karnataka. So the major threat as far as concerned, I am talking about Karnataka only. So there is a major threat. Actually, when I interacted with the officers working over there, actually there is a communication gap between Tamil Nadu and Karnataka at various levels. Right from this thing, you know, Kaveri is a very critical issue. Actually, both the sides, we do not want to, actually there is a, definitely we should agree with that. There is a actual misconcept what we say, and again, if I compare with the success case with Bandipur and interacting with Kerala and there, actually there was a lot of good interaction between the officers from higher level to the lowest poachers levels also. But if you look at the Tamil Nadu and Karnataka district, there is very less interaction. That is one of the reasons. And I will also try to bring one point in at this point of time. Actually, now smaller cases are coming up. Smaller cases, actually, this screen activities have been going on, market screen activities. So I have seen in my experience, some innocent people are getting caught. Actually, they do not know the value of filters, they do not know anything. I know for 2,000 rupees, for 1,000 rupees, they are into the smuggling activity. Actually, they have not poached the elephants. Actually, somebody has approached them to give the elephant tusk. And they are into the forest, found some elephant tusk pieces into the, they sting into the, actually not knowingly, directly they are into the trade, they are caught. Actually, some awareness has to be done.
I think what I'm trying to say is that primarily we need to stop killing elephants. So that can be possible only in the ground level. After that, whatever you do, it's not going to make a difference. With all the conflicting interests and problems what we go through. So like how we lose something and we get happy, but elephant will never be happy if the tusk is brought back. So think about it. If you provide the two things, I repeat, the two things, stop killing elephant, provide all the support in the food department, whatever way. They have to be the first source of defense. Then, if all problem is not able to be solved, then it comes back to you as a buyer. This don't matter. Only these two ways you can stop it. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.